that is the best link possible to connect Maurizio's speech with my second part of speech. Since my topic was to share with you our experiences in the field of preclinical and clinical research, I want to go on and speak about deep endometriosis, because we are performing a very beautiful study, now clinical, and already performed preclinical with the University of Rome Policlinico Gemelli, that is a famous, important university. The head of the department is Professor Fiorenzo De Cicco, and they are European Referring Institute for Endometriosis. It means that we are really at the house of the highest level for endometriosis in Europe. Okay, endometriosis, I will be very synthetic, obviously. It's a very paradigmatic disease for PRN, because in terms of etiopathogenesis, we recognize both infection and inflammation. In terms of infection, be careful with mycoplasma, because it seems to be very, very often involved in endometriosis. But first of all, endometriosis is a typical inflammatory disease, so we can really say something good for this disease. In terms of a PRN approach, with the Professor De Cicco and his equipe, we focus our attention on two moments in this disease: inflammation and progesterone resistance. Actually, these two points, inflammation and progesterone resistance, are linked, because we will see that some genes, especially on box 10 genes, that has to express the production of progesterone receptors, these genes are inhibited by interleukin 1 and interleukin 6. So progesterone resistance can be considered as expression of inflammation too. Inflammation in these patients means severe pain. So what can we do? We, according to the international literature, thought to have two main targets. First, to down-regulate interleukin 1 beta and TNF-alpha, that among the most important pro-inflammatory cytokines in deep endometriosis are the most expressed. And to stimulate, upregulate the expression of on box 10, that is the gene codifying for the receptors for progesterone. You can easily understand that if these genes are not codifying, you don't have the receptors for progesterone and you have the progesterone resistance. So this is the pathway we have to follow. Since the patient goes to you, specialist in gynecology, first of all for pain, look which are the most important mediators for pain and inflammation. COX-2, so the cascade of arachidonic acid. NGF, that's interesting. Nervous growth factor. Nervous growth factor is a growth factor with pro-inflammatory activity. Prostaglandin E2 and VEGF, vasal endothelial growth factor. That's very important, because it is good when it stimulates the neovascularization. But VEGF has a pro-inflammatory activity that is 1,000 times stronger than histamine. So it's really unbelievable. Little parenthesis, in autistic children, we can find in some precise area of the brain some perivasal inflammatory zones. Those perivasal inflammatory zones are because of they have highest level of VEGF. So even autism is also an inflammatory disease. Anyway, COX-2, NGF, PGE2, VEGF, upregulated pain. And we know that there is always one interleukin that is involved in the expression of COX-2, NGF, PGE2, VEGF. And this cytokine is especially interleukin 1 beta. These are the pathways induced by the upregulation of interleukin 1 beta in the upregulation of the mediators of inflammation. So, if we will be able to control and to reconduct interleukin 1 beta inside of the homeostatic concentration, maybe we will be acting on the deep etiology of this disease. This is what also in conventional pharmacology they do with the enogest. I don't know if the same commercial name in your Visan, okay? Okay, what Visan do also? Block COX-2 and the, this type of kinases. So, we have another solution that is, instead of to interfere with the intermediate of the cascade, the kinases and the cyclooxygenases too, why not to act on the origin of the inflammatory cascade, that is the overexpression of interleukin 1 beta? Yes, we can do that. In which way? Anti-interleukin 1 beta and interleukin 10. So, the first two medications we are considering for the treatment of deep endometriosis is act on the inflammatory origin with anti-interleukin 1 and interleukin 10. You know very well why one and why the second. Okay, the other problem was the progesterone resistance. Why progesterone resistance? Because we have a low expression of the gene on box 10, codifying for the receptor for progesterone. Why in these patients these genes are not well expressed? Once again, the cause is the increased interleukin 1 beta. So, interleukin 1 beta is a pivot not only in the process of inflammation but also for progesterone resistance. Absolutely, we have to look at this disease as an inflammatory disease. Look at the references about the crucial role played by interleukin 1 beta in endometriosis are huge, really huge. So, no problem. The problem is that which kind of solution you have to manage interleukin 1 beta? Yes, we have the specific medication for that. So, this is what we are doing in terms of a clinical protocol. Two branches. One group of patients is treated with progesterone 2.5 milligram. Control of inflamed microenvironment, enhanced progesterone sensitivity. The problem is that, especially in young patients, you have side effects and you are inducing a hypofertility. So, our goal is to reduce progesterone from 2.5 milligram to 1.25 milligram. That's crazy, because with progesterone 1.25 milligram, you are under the minimal pharmacological effective dose. But our goal will be to enhance 1.5 through progesterone from Guna, because progesterone Guna low dose works exactly upregulating the transmembrane receptors for progesterone. So even though you are providing as external medication only 1.25 milligram of progesterone, that low dose, not physiological, low pharmacological dose of progesterone will find more open receptors, so it will work better even though in lower concentration. But if you reduce the quantity of progesterone, you reduce the side effects. From the other side, we use also anti-interleukin-1 and interleukin-10. All of these three medications, 20 drops twice a day for 3 months, cycles of 3 months. It will be very interesting at the end of this protocol that is ongoing to see how the patient answers to the reduction of the conventional dosage of progesterone. Very interesting data. We will see. Maybe in next course I will have the preliminary data at least. But I can already show you the preclinical data that we did with the University of Rome, and these results have been presented at this Congress on low-dose medicine, from evidence to efficacy-based medicine, in Milan past May. These data have been presented by Professor De Cicco, who is the head of the Department of Gynecology. We focus and evaluate the efficacy of low dose of SKA, Guna, progesterone, anti-interleukin-1, interleukin-10. Very interesting is that SKA progesterone, 10 picogram per milliliter, it's a mistake, it's not picogram but femtograms, our concentration, it's an F instead of a P. These are the slides of the professor. I will say, what are you doing? Instead of to be attentive when I speak, he wrote 10 picograms. Significantly decrease 17 beta estrogen dehydrogenases and the levels of nuclear translocation of NFKB. Okay, why these data are important? Please take a look to this one, NFKB. It is a marker of inflammation. What is NFKB? This is a cell. This is the nucleus of the cell. This is the DNA of the cell. This is NFKB. This is a receptor for interleukin-1 receptor. What happened when interleukin-1 bind the receptor inside of the cell? Starts a cascade of reaction that lead to the activation of NFKB. NFKB is a protein, is a translocation factor able to go into the nucleus, activating some particular sites, sequence of DNA, for the expression and the synthesis of pro-inflammatory factors. endometriosis is an inflammatory disease. So, why anti-interleukin 1 from Guna? Because this medication works at this level, blocking the binding between interleukin 1 and its receptors. So blocking at the origin the cascade of activation of NFKB. How does interleukin 10 work? That's amazing. Interleukin 10 works directly on NFKB. Normally, NFKB is under control of another protein called IKB, inhibitor KB. In this moment, in my cells, I don't have any inflammation. Do I have NFKB? NFKB, the translocation pro-inflammatory factor? Yes, I have. But thanks God, I also have inhibitor KB that block the NFKB, not making it going into the nucleus. Interleukin 10 work avoiding the phosphorylation of IKB. That means that IKB under interleukin 10 stay tied to NFKB, not allowing it to go into the nucleus. So with the combination of anti-interleukin 1 and interleukin 10, you are completely blocking the inflammatory cascade. The combination of the two medications, by a molecular biology point of view, it's very, very, very clear. Even progesterone has a wonderful, powerful anti-inflammatory activity, because we know exactly that progesterone is able to block a subunit of NFKB. NFKB is a molecule like this. Two subunits called P50, P65. P65 is the right subunit that go into the nucleus to activate DNA. Progesterone block P65. So block the active part of the molecules that goes into the nucleus. Even testosterone, progesterone is a powerful anti-inflammatory molecule. It works both as anti-inflammatory molecule and also has a sensitization molecule for progesterone receptors. In endometriosis, very often we observe hyperestrogenism. So, progesterone, don't forget that it is the antagonistic hormone for estrogen. Why it works on 17 beta 1 estrogen dehydrogenases, acting on it. So the rationale of the therapy for endometriosis is absolutely robust by both a molecular biology point of view and a clinical point of view. Once again, for your patients, I remember that the protocol we are using in this ongoing clinical trial is anti-interleukin 1, interleukin 10, progesterone. And since you don't have to believe me, but to believe only the data, these are the data about the expression of NFKB in black control group, gray treated with Guna progesterone. This is the quantity of NFKB in the cytoplasm. Look here. and FKB normally is in the cytoplasm. Okay? When you treat the patients with progesterone and the other ones, the quantity of NFKB in the cytoplasm is higher than the control. Good! It means that it's not going into the nucleus activating the DNA. If you measure the NFKB in the nucleus using Guna progesterone, it is lower. It means that all the NFKB is in the cytoplasm and it is not cracking our nuts. Right in English, okay? And it is not in the nucleus. So we have the evidence how progesterone, anti-interleukin-1 and especially interleukin-10 block, freeze the NFKB in the cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, it doesn't disturb our cells. Interesting, look that in terms of P, they are Western blotting, so we cannot speak in terms of P. But look the difference. People say, yes, but they are low dose medications. They are slow. They are not so effective such as a high concentration of hormones. Look at that. Okay? So, if someone in your country says, okay, it's low dose. Okay, look at this paper. No problem. We can face every... Criticism, absolutely. And it was not, Roger, we worked together more than 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we didn't have any study. So it was difficult for us. Now, with all these studies, please put in front of me any of your colleague that is critic against low-dose medicine and leave it with me for 30 minutes. If she's a woman, even better. Leave me a room. Roger knows that I always have fun about this matter. No, really, we are strong now. Why this time here in Milan I'm focusing on the results of our research? Because it's the research that no one can criticize. They are numbers, so, and they are cells. So please, don't tell me it's a placebo. Because I can convince you, Roger, you stay well. But I cannot convince a cell in culture. Hey, please, produce an FKB or block an FKB. So very important, the preclinical research on isolated cells. No placebo. Placebo is always allopathy, homeopathy, phytotherapy, acupuncture. Heavy treatment has a percentage of placebo, but not the preclinical cell, research on cells. You can really help your patients. This is, once again, the protocol. This is the experimental protocol. If you want to think in terms of PRN, since, as Maurizio said, when you are acting on mucosas or serosas more than matrix, think of lympho. I think that with lympho you can help hugely your patients. Professor De Chico says, oh, since I'm using lympho, better results by a clinical point of view.
Of course, because we have
yes, exactly. So lympho is the drenin product specific for endometriosis. And you look at Cytomix. Why Cytomix is crucial the same? Because we said that endometriosis means two things. Inflammation, okay, infection. So Cytomix, that is our antibiotics, okay, has to be used to manage the infective part in the pathogenesis of endometriosis. 5 pellets twice a day for 2 to 4 months. In average, 3 months, such as well as the other product. I think that this is really an interesting an interesting protocol. I love the concept of overlapping. So you can stay with one 0.25 milligram per day of progesterone, and week after week maybe you can reduce even that 1.25 milligram per day of allopathic treatment.
What about recurrence, Alessandro?
Recurrency? We cannot tell you in terms of data because the study is ongoing. The follow-up will be after 6 months, after 12 months, and after 18 months. So at the end of the trial, we will be able also to express in terms of relapses. But at this moment, I can only speak in terms of what we are doing. By a rational point of view, is absolutely robust. The relapses will be one of the secondary endpoints of the study. Okay, we change. Wash out your mind. Stop gynecology. Tu devi andare. Ah, okay. Salutiamo. Maurizio has to go.
Sorry.
Maurizio, thank you very much. Take care. Okay, we are always in contact. Did you see Maurizio's name? You can write to Maurizio, no problem, for every consultation, or if you need to send to Maurizio your patients or everything. The email is maurizio.passafaro@gmail.com.
So it's Passafaro.
I spell maurizio.passafaro PASSAFARO@gmail.com. 24 hours per day, no problem.
Grazie a tutti per l'ascolto.
Grazie. Okay, wash out from gynecology, come back to rheumatology. You remember that yesterday we spoke about the systemic therapy for early stage symptomatic osteoarthritis. That is 80% of your patient, where you have a new opportunity to avoid the use of corticosteroids. I love corticosteroids, but for the other 20% of the cases in a very severe stage of osteoarthritis. Otherwise, anti-interleukin 1, interleukin 10. The study of the professor of rheumatology, Professor Mattucci, showed a reduction in visual analogic scale for pain from an average of 8 points to an average of 2 points in 6 months. Okay, so interesting. And already after 3 months, a significant reduction of the VAS in any case. Since we are PRM oriented and a good drainage is an half of a good therapy, even in this case, Guna Lympho has to be preferred to Guna Matrix. And Guna Arthro, that is a medication that we use to something like feed the cartilage, and Guna Flam for the presence of even beta endorphin for the management of the flare of inflammation and especially the pain. So it's quite logical, this protocol.
And because our osteoarthritis comes back, it flares up. When you say treat for 2 to 3 months, what kind of symptom-free time would you expect from that?
Yeah. Okay, usually we measure, first of all, the pain. Second, the Lekast index. Lekast index is a evaluation of this patient in terms of functionality. For instance, the time that they are able to walk without any type of pain. The rigid.
I wanted to see you again.
The rigidity of the joint at the beginning of the day. So not only the pain, but the functionality of the joint that is even more important. So, but the pain is the reason why they come to you. So sometimes in this chronic degenerative disease, you have flare of inflammation. Instead of to use acetaminophen, please use Gunaflam. It's absolutely better. So at the occurrence, Gunaflam. This is the concept.
So you'd use this protocol for 2 to 3 months.
Yeah.
And then Gunaflam just for occasion.
Exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. Or look, 10 drops every 30 minutes for 2 hours until acute symptoms disappear when you have the acute symptoms, when you have the flare. Instead, Arthro, Lympho, 10 and anti-interleukin 1, 20 drops twice a day, continuously for 3 months every day. My suggestion is 40 drops in a bottle of water to drink during the day. That's the best way of administration to have a good compliance from the patients. Look that you have 80% of your osteoarthritic patients in this condition. And really, you can do well. And even osteoarthritis, even though it's here, is a systemic disease. So treat the disease, the localized disease, as a systemic disease. This is our goal. We strongly believe in this concept. That is a Hahnemann concept. Treat the human being and not the disease. Act on the cause and not only on the symptoms. We are speaking a new modern language, but Hahnemann was another genius and he understood everything 260 years ago. So we also have the possibility to treat locally the osteoarthritis, and this is a very interesting study, clinical trial, published on the BMC musculoskeletal disorders. This is the full, this is the cover of the magazine. And it's an interesting paper because it is a comparative study between intra-articular injection of our ampule and the knee, that is a product with collagen, swine origin collagen, plus Arnica Montana for injection, versus the gold standard therapy for osteoarthritis stage 2 and 3, that is sodium hyaluronate, that is very important for viscosupplementation. So now we don't have time to speak about the difference between collagen and sodium hyaluronate, and I want to show you the results. This is the complete title, and for those of you who want to know, the impact factor of BNC is 1.8. That is quite good for that type of journals. Inclusion criteria for this study, diagnosis according to the American Rheumatism Association, over 40 years old, this is important, according to Kellgren-Lawrence scale, that is this one, all the patients had stage 2 and 3 of osteoarthritis. Stage 4 is not possible to be treated with viscosupplementation, they need the prosthesis. Okay, so these are the typical stages of osteoarthritis that we observe. Disease activity assessed according to the pain scale, VAS, and all these patients between 0 and 10 in terms of intensity of pain had to have at least 4. And for me it's very interesting, this index, Lecast index, that measure the functionality. So, okay, you know already this. In terms of Lecast index, pain or discomfort, maximum distance walked, activities of daily living. This is the answer to your question. It's considered very severe when the points are between 11 and 13. Look, remember this scale. 11 to 13, very severe osteoarthritis. So this is the synoptic table of all the patients enrolled. They were around 70 years old, both the group treated with Guna, MD knee, and with hyaluronic acid. More women than men, BMI a little over 25, 24.9, that is perfect, like me. I'm joking. Kellgren-Lawrence, you remember, Kellgren-Lawrence, second stage and third stage. Lekes index, you remember, 11 to 13, very severe. The average of Kellgren-Lawrence was 12.5. So they were severe patients. Not okay, it's placebo. No, no. Pain VAS around 7.5. Consider the scale is 0 to 10. So they were not happy. We treat this patient, 29, with two vials of ND knee once a week for 5 weeks, and the other group 2.5 milliliters intra-articularly once a week for 5 weeks with ARST, that is the commercial name of hyaluronic acid we use here in Italy, and it's considered the best hyaluronic acid. The results, unbelievable. This is a control study. In red, here's the Lekes index assessed by MDME, red, hyaluronic acid, blue. You can see that MDME in terms of Lekes index is a little more effective than hyaluronic acid. I mean, in terms of recovery of functionality, is better. For those of you who are expert in terms of clinical studies, since the standard deviation is very big, we can say that both the product, the allopathic product, and the collagen from Guna are effective the same in recovering the functionality. In terms of pain, the same. In terms of pain, the collagen injectable from Guna is not inferior than hyaluronic acid. And hyaluronic acid is considered the gold standard. There is a little difference that one ampule of hyaluronic acid is 100 euros. So the expense for the patients is very high. Since as Guna, we think that everybody has to have the access to the best cure, we keep the prices affordable for everybody. And this is the most interesting data I want to show to you. And it is the consumption of acetaminophen as painkiller escape therapy for the patient in the group treated with hyaluronic acid and the group treated with MD. I mean, the guys treated with the Guna collagen needed less acetaminophen by oral to control the pain than the group treated with hyaluronic acid. So, I think that for all your patients with osteoarthritis stage 2 and 3, Kellgren-Lawrence, if you apply the systemic therapy, anti-interleukin 1, interleukin 10, Guna Lympho, and Guna Arthro, and if you have available in your country the ampules for periarticular or intraarticular injection, I think that you can give a new hope to these patients. These are the data. So I speak only through the data, and they are really impressive. Nice. Gout. In Italy, we think that patients with gout are not so many. Instead, it is a disease that is progressively increasing. We use only one medication, we, Professor Matucci at the University of Florence, and the medication has been Guna interleukin 1. This is the percentage, the prevalence of gout in your country. In the United Kingdom, 0.3 to 1% of population. In USA, 2.5, 3.9. McDonald's. Hamburger.
Kentucky.
Yes. New York strips, and so on. China, 1.14. Look at New Zealand, 10 to 14% of people with gout. Anyway, in Europe, we are very similar to UK. Anyway, it's a problem. You have patients with gout. It is a disease age dependent. Unfortunately, women are more affected than women, with a ratio that is 2.7 to 1. And the prevalence in general is male, 5 to 28 patients every 1,000, female, 1 to 6. The problem is that it is increasing. And the problem is that doesn't exist any effective therapy. What do you do normally for the treatment of gout according to the international guideline? You use normally two very effective, that means with very severe side effect drugs, that are allopurinol. That is against uric crystals. And colchicine. The international protocol say that you have to use allopurinol 300 milligram per day and colchicine 1 milligram per day. Okay, they say this, and they say doesn't exist anything else. Look, some of the side effects of allopurinol when used 100 milligram daily, but they saw that 100 milligram daily is not effective. So now they increased 300 milligram daily. Steven Johnson syndrome, erythema multiforme. I don't think patients love this side effect. So what we did, and these are the results. We did an overlapping therapy. Professor Matucci did that. He was treating his patients with allopurinol since long time. So he started here. Allopurinol and colchicine. In terms of pain, visual analogic scale, these patients were assessed around 6, so painful. Allopurinol and colchicine, allopurinol and colchicine, allopurinol and colchicine, nothing. Allopurinol and colchicine plus 20 drops twice a day of anti-interleukin 1. At this moment, please look the trend of the pain in these patients after inserting in the gold standard therapy scheme the low dose medication Guna anti-interleukin 1. After 3 months from 6 of VAS to 4, and after 6 months from 6 to less than 2. The P is 0.001. So, to be effective, statistically, you have to have 0.05, so we are much less than 0.05, so very significant. That's amazing because it shows the effectiveness of interleukin-1 low dose SKA. You have patients with gout. You can give them a new hope. This is the reason why we work really in our laboratories with research, investing millions of euros, because these studies I'm presenting to you, they cost, but so much. But we think that this is the way we have to follow to present our company to the international scientific community. So we invest, no problem. Okay, therapy. Anti-interleukin-1 according to the experimental protocol. Very interesting is in terms of drainage matrix, because gout is a matrix disease. Lympho to help the drainage of the crystals of urate through the lymphatic vessel and open the faucet of the kidney excretion through the diure. I think that especially in gout, that is a metabolic toxic disease, you need to put your patient under deep drainage. In terms of experimental protocol, we couldn't test so many drugs. Otherwise, the referee say yes, but what is working? So just anti-interleukin-1. And to manage the flares of acute inflammation, Guna Flam. The same, it's always the same approach. So, new possibilities for hands and knee osteoarthritis, for gout, and I want to ask you, but you have to answer me, for rheumatoid arthritis, what can you think of in terms of protocol? His rheumatoid arthritis, I don't show you the protocol, eh? Is the rheumatoid arthritis an inflammatory disease?
Yeah.
Is it a progressive, chronic, degenerative inflammatory disease?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which interleukins could be upregulated in these patients? Interleukin-6, no question. 17, right, because rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune disease. So, autoimmune disease means Th17, and which is the work, the dirty job of Th17? Producing interleukin-17, right. And the third, upregulated, dramatically upregulated interleukin in a knee with rheumatoid arthritis is TNF-alpha. So, interleukin-6, TNF-alpha, interleukin-17. How can we block interleukin-6? Which is the opposing cytokine of 6? 10. Interleukin-10, maybe it's right. How can we block TNF-alpha? With infliximab, no. There is an association, a combination of two, anti-interleukin-1 plus interleukin-10, together they work as an anti-TNF-alpha. So, interesting to combine interleukin-10 with anti-interleukin-1. And how can down-regulate interleukin-17? Which is that interleukin that is able to down-regulate Th17? The 4. Exactly. This has been the protocol used by Professor Alberto Migliore of the Hospital San Pietro Fate Bene Fratelli of the University of Rome. He's a very famous, another famous Italian rheumatologist. Very interesting, the protocol he established. He took patient with severe rheumatoid arthritis and divide them in two groups. Both the two groups for 6 months have been treated because of the severity of their rheumatoid arthritis with anti-TNF alpha, I mean infliximab, the monoclonal antibody that is exactly indicated for rheumatoid arthritis. And it is right, because the inflammation in the joint of this patient is so severe that he needed to have the atomic bomb in terms of pharmacology to block anti-TNF-alpha. The problem using infliximab, this type of monoclonal anti-TNF-alpha antibody, is that you cannot go on for more than 6 months. Otherwise, you have very severe side effects. I mean, they die for infections. So, according to the international guideline, the protocol is, during the time you don't use the infliximab, to keep down the activity of the disease, you must use corticosteroids or DMARDs, drug-modifying rheumatoid arthritis disease. The first group has been treated with cortisone or DMARDs. The other group has been treated with interleukin-1, anti-interleukin-1, interleukin-10, interleukin-4 for 3 months. And then they evaluate after the 3 months of treatment if the disease was kept down by the two different treatments. So this is a not inferiority study design. Look that the results will be published on drug design development and therapy impact factor 2.8. This is a news that we received 3 days ago. We have been accepted, and now this paper is in press. We demonstrated that interleukin-10 plus anti-interleukin-1 plus interleukin-4 are effective controlling the activity of severe rheumatoid arthritis as well as cortisone or DMARDs. That's huge, because you treat the pain with cortisone, but you have the side effects of cortisone. So now we can absolutely say this combination of three interleukins are the same of cortisone or DMARDs, controlling the activity of the disease. That is the goal of that study, and it is the primary endpoint. You have patients with rheumatoid arthritis. You can give always the same words. You can give a new hope to your patients. If I have 5 minutes, do I have
3 minutes?
3 minutes, okay. Thank you very much. No, because you asked me about vitiligo, okay?
Yeah.
And it is an experience, a very deep and long experience in the field of vitiligo. We work with the most important dermatologist in the world, as expert of vitiligo. He is a professor from the University of Florence, and I have had the honor to work with him speaking about low-dose treatment of vitiligo twice in India, I will tell you why in India, and once at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York. This is just to make you aware where PRN is accepted now. Was very different, Roger, when we were young 10 years ago, speaking about something without any evidence, but with the awareness we were on the right way. So, vitiligo, which kind of, I ask you, which kind of disease is vitiligo? First of all, what we are speaking of in these 2 days is an inflammatory disease. Is a low-grade chronic inflammatory disease. Some of you said something absolutely true. It's a systemic disease. It's not a skin disease. It's a systemic disease where mind is involved, immune system is involved, endocrine system is involved. Okay, by an immunological point of view, if you look at the blood of these patients, they have Th1 upregulated, Th17 upregulated. So, inflammation, autoimmune disease. Someone said it is an autoimmune disease. Yes, but not only of the skin. Mm-hmm. It's an autoimmune disease of the entire body. Of the entire body. In fact, the mental involvement, the psychological involvement of these patients is very, very high. Why these poor guys have Th1 and Th17 so high? Let's go to the origin. Because they have a very high level of hyperoxidative stress. In other terms, they have very high free radicals. Why Professor Lotti and I went to India? Because in India, the prevalence of vitiligo is 80% of the population. 90 million, they are 1.2 billion people. 90 million of Indians have vitiligo. In the United Kingdom, in Italy, we have 0.3 to 0.5% of prevalence. So why Indians are so unlucky? Could be something related to genetics? No. Okay. No, because only 23% of homozygote twins develop together vitiligo. So in terms of statistically significance, no. So, how? What can be the cause? On this big, exactly, on this big part of population, to induce something changing their immune asset, only two possibilities, drugs or food. In the case, exactly, in the case of Indians, food is the cause of the hyperoxidative stress. Why? They eat a lot of species. And species, and especially they eat, but when I say a lot, I mean a lot, eh?
Spices.
Okay, thank you. Spices. Right, Spice Girl. A lot of spices. And now I terrify you. I want to terrify you. Because among those spices, they eat especially a lot of curcuma. Curcuma longa, maybe you call in your country turmeric. Okay. Inside of curcuma there is a substance named curcumina. If you read some papers, not index papers, everybody says curcumin has an antioxidant activity. Yes, it's right. The antioxidant activity of curcumin is if you eat small quantity of curcuma. So don't worry. But if you eat curcuma since you are 2 years old every day in big quantity, it is a super oxidative stress for the immune system. So, what happens for the cells of the skin? Oxidative stress stimulates the immune system to produce TNF-alpha in big quantity. Look at the cascade. TNF-alpha kills keratinocytes. Keratinocytes. Make TNF-alpha upregulated, makes keratinocytes in apoptosis. Keratinocytes are the most important skin cells able to talk to melanocytes. Melanocytes are the cells which produce melanin, the color of the skin. Keratinocytes are able to tell melanocytes, hey, my friend, please produce melanin. In this way, no, through a signaling molecule that is fibroblast growth factor. So what happens? Hyperoxidative stress, too much TNF-alpha, apoptosis of keratinocytes. Keratinocytes is not more able, through FGF, to tell melanocytes produce melanin, and melanocytes don't work. So, starting from this cascade, what Professor Lotti thought, why not to reestablish the crosstalk between keratinocytes and melanocytes? So he thought to provide FGF low dose, 20 drops twice a day. Then, which kind of disease is vitiligo? Why keratinocytes go in apoptosis? Because of inflammation. So, you know very well, anti-interleukin-1, interleukin-10, interleukin-4. 20 drops twice a day, 20 drops twice a day, 20 drops twice a day. And in the clinical trial they performed, and now I show you, there are a lot, in your syllabus you have many, many slides about vitiligo and also psoriasis. Okay, this is the clinical trial conducted in 5 different countries of the world. Vitiligo, successful combination treatment based on oral low dose cytokines 1, 2, 3, and 4, and different topical treatments. They selected, this is important, patient with vitiligo not over 15% of their body surface. And they treated one group only with cytokines, one group only with microphototherapy, one group overlapping microphototherapy and low-dose cytokines. The results is really unbelievable, even for us. Positive results were obtained both with low-dose cytokines alone or in association with microphototherapy, with positive percentage of skin repigmentation between 74% and 90%. They repigmented their patches. And 100% of stop for the spreading of the lesion. If you look at your patient with vitiligo, they live with the terror. They are terrifying every morning looking at their mirror to see a new spot of the previous spot bigger. So to block the spreading is already a great result. 100% in blocking the spreading. From 70% to 90% repigmented. These are just some pictures This is a picture taken by one of the doctors that maybe you know, Dr. Marco Del Prete, who spoke to you sometimes. July 20, 2015, September 7, 2015. So after 40 days, the protocol was 3 to 6 months. Please go on, eh? The experience is that more you do this therapy, better you take under control. Look here, look here. So it's a picture, eh? And look that it was summer. And it's not true that during summer, vitiligo patient improved. It's the opposite, because they have a tan around and not here. So normally, with the tan, you see more the lesions. That's just one picture. So, since they suffer in an unbelievable way, in India, women with vitiligo cannot get married. And if you are married, and during your marriage, vitiligo appears, that's, according to the Indian law, reason for repudiation. Okay? The husband can say, okay, go away. So you can imagine the sufferance. In fact, they speak in terms of social stigma and psychological burden that is unbelievable. Can we help those type of patients? Yes, we can help them. That's really important. Behind the clinical trials, we have also preclinical trials on cells. So please don't tell me it's a placebo, eh? Otherwise I show you the cells, but we don't have time, so believe me, it's not a placebo. Okay, I think it's time, otherwise it's so long, but I think that really now you have an idea of our big effort in research. With this data, no one can tell you, I don't believe. So, thank you very much for your attention, and good luck to yourself.